video, I explain what is a Bayesian t-test, how to conduct it, and how to interpret it. The aim is to provide you the means to properly perform this kind of analysis using the JASP software or the bias factor package in R. Whether Bayesian or Frequentist, t-tests are a family of tests that can be used for comparing means of normally distributed variables between groups of observations or to test them against a reference value. The term Frequentist refers to the usual approach taught in statistics courses that relies on the use of p-values. We distinguish between three types of t-test. For now, we focus on the one-sample t-test and discuss the independent samples and paired samples versions of the test later. Keep in mind that the idea is virtually the same for any of the three. We first consider the Frequentist one-sample t-test. It is a statistical method used to compare a sample's mean to a known or hypothesized population mean. Imagine running a study testing the hypothesis that watching dumb movies makes people dumber. Your prediction is that people who have just watched a dumb movie, say Dumb and Dumber with Jim Carrey and Jeff Daniels, will have their cognitive performances reduced. The average performance on a cognitive test in your study sample of 40 participants is 44.2. This score is below the average reference value of 50 taken from the ordinary population. You wish to test whether this negative difference generalizes beyond the study sample at the level of the population. You run a hypothesis test on the corresponding parameter m. M is the parameter value that describes the mean performance on the cognitive test in the population of people right after watching a dumb movie. The test contrasts two hypotheses as follows. H0 states that m equals 50. H1 states that m is different from 50. You compute a frequentist one-sample t-test in R, and it yields a test statistic of -2.86. The p-value for the test statistic is about 0.007, which falls under the alpha rejection criterion of 0.05. This means that the difference between the sample mean and the reference value is statistically significant. We therefore reject the null hypothesis and conclude that, after watching a dumb movie, people have their cognitive performances reduced. Rejecting the null hypothesis at the level of alpha of 0.05 means that we make sure to maintain the false positive rate under control because the data would appear less than 5% of the time had we run the study an endless number of times, assuming that watching a dumb movie has no effect on one's cognitive performances. The frequentist version of the t-test allows taking a dichotomous decision whether to reject or accept a hypothesis while maintaining the error rate committed by repeating this procedure in the long run. Performing a Bayesian t-test also consists in pitting the null hypothesis against an alternative. Instead of taking a binary decision, a Bayesian t-test allows quantifying by how much some data are more likely to have occurred under one hypothesis than under the other. A typical result obtained with a Bayesian analysis is a statement such as the data are 4.5 times more likely to have occurred under the alternative hypothesis than under the null hypothesis, or the data favor 10 times the null hypothesis over the alternative, or yet the data don't favor any of the two hypotheses. To do this, conducting a Bayesian t-test involves computing a Bayes factor, which is the Bayesian statistic used for hypothesis testing. The Bayes factor is a continuous measure that compares the predictive accuracy of two hypotheses, meaning it compares the degree to which each hypothesis predicted the observed data. This equation is derived from Bayes' theorem and reads that the Bayes factor 1.0 is the ratio between the probability of data under the alternative hypothesis H1 and the probability of data under the null hypothesis H0. The Bayes factor value can be interpreted in the following way. A Bayes factor value greater than 1 means that the data provide evidence for the alternative hypothesis compared with the null hypothesis. A Bayes factor value smaller than 1 means that the data lends support for the null hypothesis compared with the alternative hypothesis. Finally, a Bayes factor value equal to 1 means that the data are equally well explained by both the null and the alternative hypothesis. This situation means absence of evidence. The data are insensitive to differentiate between H0 and H1. In practice, we can use conventionally accepted cutoffs and interpret Bayes factor values accordingly. The convention presented here uses the values of 3 and 1/3 as the cutoffs. If the Bayes factor value is greater than 3, we conclude that data support the alternative hypothesis over the null hypothesis. If the Bayes factor value is smaller than 1/3, we conclude that the data support the null hypothesis over the alternative hypothesis. If the Bayes factor value is somewhere in between 1/3 and 3, we conclude that there is no evidence for any of the two. Note that these cutoffs are somewhat arbitrary and may vary across communities. For instance, some communities may be more stringent and set 10 and 1/10 as the cutoffs for evidence. I will now explain how the Bayes factor is calculated. While this may be a bit technical, please bear with me before you see how it is actually calculated using JASP. You now know that the Bayes factor is a ratio between the probabilities of some data under two hypotheses. The probability of some data under a hypothesis is also referred to as the marginal likelihood. The marginal likelihood is the sum of products between two components. The first component is the likelihood function, and the second component is the prior. The likelihood function specifies the model we use to describe the data. In other words, it describes the probability of observing some data given the model structure and parameters. In the case of the one-sample t-test, the data can be modeled using the normal distribution that uses m and sd square as the mean and variance parameters, respectively. The prior specifies the prior distribution of probability across all the values of parameters theta that are involved in the likelihood function. The prior indicates what parameter values are assumed the most likely to be true before seeing the data. The prior can be conveniently understood as a statistical representation of what your hypothesis predicts. The marginal likelihood can be formally expressed with this equation that you will easily encounter across the literature. That's why we present it here. Hopefully, at this point, you will have developed the conceptual understanding that the marginal likelihood is the probability of some data under some hypothesis. It can be obtained by summing the products between the likelihood function and the prior that is used to allocate more or less weight to the parameter values for which we compute the likelihood. Theoretically, computing the Bayes factor would require you to specify prior distributions for all the parameter values involved in both hypotheses, H0 and H1. The approach for the Bayesian one-sample t-test presented here proposes a convenient solution that consists in setting a prior on the standardized effect size delta under the alternative hypothesis H1. Simply put, this approach requires you to commit to a range of effect sizes you estimate plausible according to expectations. Both the JASP software and RO follow the same approach and propose to set a prior on the standardized effect size under the alternative hypothesis H1. It is called the JZS prior. It uses a Cauchy distribution, which is a t-distribution with a single degree of freedom. The shape of a Cauchy distribution resembles a normal distribution but has heavier tails. This means that a Cauchy distribution allocates more prior probability to stronger effect sizes than a normal distribution. It is centered on a value of 0, meaning that effect sizes close to 0 are assumed to be the most likely to be true before seeing data. In this sense, the JZS is a default prior, meaning that it reflects a minimum degree of information and accommodates a wide range of situations. Note, however, that the JASP software also allows specifying an informed prior with a mean different from 0. The JZS prior involves a scale parameter R that quantifies the interquartile range of expected effect sizes under H1. The default value of the R parameter for a one-sample t-test is set at 0.707. This means that the alternative hypothesis predicts that 50% of expected effect sizes will fall within the red area under the curve you see on the graph, and 50% of expected effect sizes will fall within the blue area. Note that the default value of 0.707 is arbitrary and has no straightforward theoretical justification. For the resulting Bayes factor calculation to be meaningful, the scale parameter needs to be adjusted according to your expected range of effect sizes. By adjusting the scale parameter, you can set the prior to the range of expected sizes under your hypothesis. This is particularly important when small effect sizes are to be expected, such as ranging from 0.20 to 0.30. If you use the default 0.707 value while you expect such small effect sizes, your analysis might easily provide evidence for H0 or provide no evidence at all. Detailed explanations on why this is the case can be found in the links provided in the description of this video. Here is the intuitive explanation. Higher values on the R-scale parameter mean that the prior puts increasingly more weight on bigger effect sizes. Thus, the higher the R-scale parameter, the more observing a small effect size will be compatible with the prediction under the null hypothesis than with the prediction made under the alternative hypothesis. Now I will illustrate how to run a Bayesian one-sample t-test in JASP. We use the same dataset as before, and we assume that our theory and hypothesis lead us to expect a minimum effect size. Therefore, we will set the R-scale parameter value on 0.50 instead of using the default value of 0.707. We begin by loading the data. We click on the t-test tab and select the Bayesian one-sample t-test. We select which variable to submit to the test. We enter the test value, here 50. Then we click on the prior tab below and set 0.50 as the scale parameter value, and the result pops up immediately. Computing the Bayesian one-sample t-test yields a bias factor value of 6.5. This means that our data are 6.5 times more likely to have occurred under the alternative hypothesis H1 than under the null hypothesis H0, which provides evidence for the former in comparison with the latter. As a standard practice, it is recommended to perform robustness check analysis. We compute several bias factor values for different priors to assess the extent to which the result is robust against reasonable variations in the prior width. Ideally, we would like the analysis to point toward the same conclusion regardless of the exact shape of the prior. In JASP, we can easily obtain robustness check analysis by selecting the corresponding option. The figure plots the bias factor values as function of the Cauchy prior width. As you can see, the bias factor values we obtain are comprised between 3 and 10 for most of the priors considered in this analysis, so the result is robust. In R, we can use the bias factor package to conduct the same analysis. We use the same data as before. We use the t-test BF function and use the R-scale argument to set the R-scale parameter to 0.50 just as before. This procedure gives us the same value of 6.5 we obtained in JASP. Performing robustness checks in R requires using the same code and adjusting the prior with the R-scale argument. As you can see, regardless of whether the prior assumes smaller or bigger effect sizes, the analysis yields quantitatively similar values, hence the result is robust. Finally, performing independent samples and paired samples t-test follows the same rationale as presented so far. The only thing that changes is the meaning of the standardized effect size delta. In the independent samples t-test, delta corresponds to a standardized mean difference between the two population parameters. In the paired samples t-test, delta corresponds to a standardized mean difference between the two repeated measures. This video was an introduction to a Bayesian t-test. The link to the dataset and the R script can be found in the description of the video, along with further readings discussing how to customize priors, how to test directional hypotheses, the pros and the cons of using this approach in comparison with the frequentist statistics.